Dudes, what is happening? This is Trent, and today I want to give you a bit of an advanced sketchbook pro walkthrough. You might recognize this image. I had actually posted the line art for it sometime last year, but I was asked by ImagineFX magazine to do a bit more of an in-depth tutorial on Sketchbook Pro, most specifically on colorizing some grayscale line arts. And I tend to do a lot of my designs in gray and not even really get to color sometimes, because it gives me an opportunity to not really think too much about materials or lighting and focus on the character designs and the details, the storytelling in the drawings. So first of all, one of the cool things about Sketchbook Pro is that it's very accessible. I come from a comic book background, which means I'm used to drawing on paper. I'm used to drawing with acrylics or traditional mediums. And Sketchbook Pro is really kind of strips away a lot of the unnecessary menus and things that you find in something like a Photoshop or a Corel Painter. Those programs can be very intimidating, but Sketchbook Pro, I mean, you pretty much open it up and you immediately recognize a series of different types of pencils and basic brushes, and you start to play around with it, and it all feels very familiar if you're used to working with traditional materials. And one of the things about Photoshop is that it was designed for photo manipulation, whereas Sketchbook Pro is designed for the artist and for traditional mediums. So it's really easy to get this natural grit and grain, and that's really what I kind of aimed for when I did this piece. I used a lot of the brushes that already exist with the software. There's really not anything new except for the chain brush, which I also created a tutorial. If you wanted to learn how to create custom brushes, Sketchbook Pro is actually really robust underneath the hood. If you dig into it, you can do a lot of custom work and create custom brush palettes and even create color layers and layer effects such as overlays and everybody's favorite dodge and burn glow brushes or glow layer effects. It's pretty much got everything that you need if you're looking to do digital art. Of course, you need a Wacom tablet if you're going to do this kind of a thing. My original tutorial was about 3 hours. I think this whole painting I ended up spending about 12 hours on. And that just made for a very exhausting recording process. There is a much longer version of this video in sort of a more of a tutorial format out there through ImagineFX. But for now, let's really kind of give you the step-by-step. I mean, as you're seeing right now, I'm not doing anything particularly fancy. I'm using some multiply layers, some darken layers, some lighten layers to establish my values. I'm not worrying about color at all. I don't want to think about color. I want to think about the character's design and telling an interesting story. I want to think about image flow. I want to make sure that everything in my image really points to the focal point. In this case, the focal point is the dragon head. But how do we add some color? So we've got almost all of our values in place. We know the layout of our image. We know where everything is going to be. We've even got some detail that we've done in our grayscale values at this point. So the next thing that we want to do is create a color layer. So we create a new layer, and then we switch that to a color mode. And then, of course, there's the handy paint bucket that allows you to just go in and fill in the whole thing. And that just basically colorized our whole image. The next thing that we could do is go in and start to paint in the color on the same layer, paint in the color for the dragon. Now, how do we know what a good color would be? Well, first of all, the whole image is a little too saturated, but we're going to back that off eventually. This is sort of what we call the flats. This stage would be generally referred to as flat colors. And what that is because we've already added a lot of the values to our image. We painted the whole thing in grayscale for the most part. Now we're really just, we don't want to add a lot of detail with the paint. So we're really just laying in what kind of hues that, or what kind of color that those values will hold. And it really doesn't matter what they are, except that if you want to amplify your contrast, we can refer back to the primary ways of creating contrast and controlling the viewer's eye. One is, of course, color contrast. And so we're going to use a cooler color, since our background is really kind of a warm color. We want to choose a cooler color so that we can, for the dragon and for Mao, so that we can pop them right out of there. We'll get a very strong presence and pop out from that background if we use a cooler color for the foreground elements. It's good practice to separate your objects onto their own colorized layer. This is sort of like creating a mask as well, because there is a handy little button that you can push next to the layer to lock that layer. And what that would mean is that you can only paint on the colors that are present on that layer. That's essentially like creating a mask. I'm going to speed it up again here for a little bit. That's essentially like creating a color mask. And you can mask out all of your different objects and then just select the layer that you want to paint on. That's one approach. I'm still sort of devising a method and an approach to how best to attack all this stuff in Sketchbook Pro, because I'm used to working with different tools. But what I'm finding is that it works pretty well. You can actually optimize your layers very efficiently like this. I think that I wanted to really pop out the contrast a little bit more, and I didn't want to just do a generic green dragon, so I switched up his colors. I wanted to get a little bit more of a koi fish kind of a color vibe, or a fish kind of a color vibe, to the dragon. I don't know why, I just tend to sometimes take the completely unexpected, or I tend to try to find something that didn't really exist before or is an unusual and unexpected approach, and I try to infuse that into my designs. In this case, I really wanted his tail to feel fishy. It just felt right to me. This story of the character is sort of developing as I'm doing these paintings. Do you know what I mean? And even throughout the image of the character, I wanted to have a little bit of a feeling of a gradient going across from his tail up into his horns. And as you can see, that orange has really kind of gotten backed off a lot. I went down into that orange layer and I just adjusted the opacity. There's a cool blue bar on the right side that allows you to adjust the opacity of a layer. And that really allows you to back things off. And layers are something that I highly recommend you spend a little time digging into. As you can see, I went back on one of my decisions, and I just went for this really blown out, saturated look. And it felt right at the time, but sometimes when you're working on something for about 10 hours, you can really get lost in it. And you start to second guess some of your decisions. And in fact, you stop second guessing some of your other decisions. And so I actually felt like this was a good call. I felt like, oh, I'll just really pop out the blues with this orange and then get these purple sort of shadow colors. And it was working, and I think it would have been fine. But the problem was that there was nowhere for the viewer's eye to rest at all. And ultimately, I ended up making the change to have a much more blue kind of a background, or a desaturated background, so that you'll really see the glow around his head and around his horns as they're sort of glowing. But in this stage, we're basically in the stage of detailing in color and detailing in paint. And I tend to like a lot of control. I tend to not necessarily want to smudge too much. So I was using pretty much the same standard in out of the box pencil that you can find. It just comes in one of the original brush options. I use a little bit of the more grainy artist's brush pencil, but for the most part, what you're seeing is what you're getting. And it's, I wanted to keep this one very simple, so that it's not something that I wanted you to know that I wasn't using some magical trickery. You're using the same exact tools that I'm using. You're using the same exact brushes that I'm using, and you've got access to all of the same techniques and approaches. It's just a matter of spending more and more time with it. And I want to highly encourage you to find processes that work well for you. If you really want to avoid dealing with color, try doing your whole image in monochromatic, just you as in like one color, and then add a splash of a saturated color to an area where you want the viewer to focus their attention. And what'll happen if you do that is that you begin to develop a sense of what colors work well together. And you generally want to do something that's sort of like in a two-thirds kind of an approach, where you've got one-third of your color is your secondary color and two-thirds of your image is your main focus color. In this case, I think that was my big problem with too much reds. Everything was competing, and the levels of saturation were pretty much too consistent across the whole image, and it was like having 100 voices screaming at you rather than having a couple of voices screaming at you. It became difficult to understand and decipher what was the important part of the image. And it's important for you to recognize What is the important part of your drawing? What's the purpose? What's the whole point of it all? In this case, I had set my standard before I even began to decide that this was going to be an image that I wanted to really capture these epic battles that were going to take place in Twilight Monk. And that's kind of my yardstick too, by the way, your intentions. When you set your intentions at the beginning of your drawing, that's how you know when you're done. And you could keep going as long as those intentions are met. But for me, I have so many orders for so many different paintings that I've got to do right now that I need to really focus on what were those intentions. And as you can see, I started to strip out a lot of the unnecessary details from those line arts. They worked well as a black and white image, but once I got into color, they were just distracting. They were disrupting the flow. I still like that chain that's sort of swirling around his tail, and I like having those spikes and the spears going through his tail. It really kind of creates like this harpoon look, like he's some kind of deep sea dragon that's popped up. You'll notice I already feel a lot better about backing off that orange. It's a lot less intense, and that makes the dragon really pop out a lot more. I wanted to darken up my line art a little bit more so that you can really see the contrast between the dragon. There are multiple ways that you can create contrast. The most effective I found are values, so light to dark. If something's really high contrast, if you have a strong dark next to a strong light color, you're going to get a lot of contrast out of that. The viewer's eye will gravitate towards it. You'll notice that all the shadow lights, the secondary lights and the shadows are actually pretty soft. And the other thing is color contrast. And I lost a little bit of that color contrast, but because of the saturation contrast, it didn't matter. That's what saved me. And you'll notice how all of the color saturation is in the focal point. So you'll see it in the tail, and you'll see it in the eyes and the face. And that blue really pops out. And then all the purples are very soft throughout the whole image. And that really allows us to focus our attention on the swoosh and the flow and the color contrast of the whole dragon's body, going from his tail, wrapping up into all of those spikes and shells and scales across his body, into his fingers that are pointing directly down and right back into his chest area, which again creates another arrow that leads all to his face, which then leads to Mao. And when you're looking at this image, my hope is that we get a feeling that there is no way that this little monk who's about to dropkick this massive fish dragon is going to possibly survive this. That was the whole goal of this painting. And the more I dug into it, the more I just kind of got lost in maybe, oh man, maybe he's got like these mystical, like glowing claws that he just look like they could just rip something to shreds. Every single part of this dragon looks dangerous, except for that flowing, smooth, whimsical fish tail, man. A couple of key takeaways from this painting. I had started out with a colorized layer, and it worked out pretty well. I think it was very valuable to create the masks for different parts of the dragon's body and for different elements in the painting. I think that in hindsight, I would probably start with a little bit more of a completely cool background and then add in a little bit of warmth into my focal points. I would probably maybe jump into color before I rendered out so much of the line work. So much detail gets lost in this, and if I make a poster print of it, it should hold up. It's the kind of piece that draws you in and has a lot of tiny little details here and there when you look at it for a little while. But it still has a very strong initial read too. Now, there's a lot of detail. There is a lot of detail where there is detail in this piece and the scales and things like that. There's little subtle things that are hidden in there as well. And I got carried away with that. I don't mind that so much, except that I struggled through this. The biggest challenge was that I was so convinced that it should be of this warm kind of a setting, a really hot setting, because that would make the viewer uncomfortable. But I didn't realize that the saturation contrast and the sharp shape language would be enough to create a discomfort for the audience, for the viewer. That was enough to really sell the idea. And in fact, this is one of my favorite paintings right now. And it's weird to me that I was able to sort of recover it. And I'm so grateful for ImagineFX asking me to revisit this piece and to, hopefully I've been able to shed a little bit of light on my process and how I'm adapting to using some of these new tools and what's awesome about these new tools and some of the neat things that I've been discovering about it. I really hope that this is helpful for you in your artistic journey, your adventure into Sketchbook Pro. So there we have it. That is his name is Grizzlock. I don't think I mentioned that, but his name is Grizzlock, and he was a chained dragon in the universe of the Legend of Twilight Monk. And this is a series of novels that you could pick up on my Gumroad or if you find them online. But super glad that you guys came along for the ride. I really hope that you got a lot out of this. If there's something that you'd like to know, go ahead and drop a comment. If I can't respond, then someone in the community probably will. Super cool community of commenters here. If you'd like to see more of my tutorials, I do have a ton of them. I have a box set of tutorials on Gumroad and like every other artist now. These are lengthy, meaty documents of these paintings, every painting that I've done for the last 3 years, and you can dissect the heck out of them. So go check those out if you're interested. And if you just like cool art and you'd like to see some new pieces come together, please subscribe. All right, dudes, that does it for me for this video. And remember, if you're gonna draw a dragon, draw your dragon with passion. All right, dudes, that's it for me. Catch you in the next video. Ciao.